Okay. Speaking about stereotypes, a few years ago here in Podgorica, I had a chance to hear a lady who said, no, we are not for NATO because with NATO is coming prostitutions in our countries. Am I right? And later on she said, my son is going to the mission in Afghanistan, and I asked, if he is going to pay young lady for prostitution. So it's very easy to complain about other, but when you put yourself in feet of other person, we have to speak differently. Because no one mother will have a power or a cheek to say, my son is going somewhere to abuse other people. And question for Irina, if it's possible that somebody who is making stereotypes, and media for sure is that tool, it's possible to break up or broke
the stereotypes.
To break stereotypes.
Yeah, definitely. Media is only a tool which is used rather to promote and to enforce some stereotypes or to break them. But the thing is that nowadays the reality is that there are people, mighty people, who are behind media. And speaking about independent media, it's a difficult question, I would say. So But everything is possible, of course. And I think that if there are more efforts somehow to, probably not to do it like straightforward activity or straightforward campaign of breaking stereotypes concerning human peace and war, but like using a kind of soft power step by step and do it not explicitly but implicitly, then this will be more effective. But media is something that we need to reach people, to reach wider audience.
May I add to that? Because we have been involved in educational programs for the past 25 years. And when I said earlier that stereotypes can be affected until the age of 18 at the most, it's because we are also doing a summer school for teenagers. We have been doing a university program for the 25 years, and I went lower the age, 15 to 18, for personal reasons, for my son as a matter of fact, and created an international summer camp where we were discussing all these issues, not just discussing, because that was, it still is a global first. We tried different methods. We decided that simulations, for example, are the best. And it's exactly the time where they are wise enough to realize what has been going on, soft enough to take in the change. So I would suggest programs like this everywhere, international and local, but the method has to be thought of. Because if you give lectures, for example, to the young ones, one lecture, two lectures, three lectures, oh, they'll listen to it. It will stay with them for maybe a week. You have to involve them in order to affect them. It's a long educational process. And another thing we have been doing for years is the so-called Euromed Journalism Institute. Because one way of provoking change, I'll use these words, is to take the professionals and educate the professionals themselves. So we were taking in international group of young journalists who had been working at least 1 year. So they were not students, they were professionals. And we were doing a week-long course. We couldn't do anymore. The key of success to these is the follow-up. It is very important. Even here, I would suggest, try to remember in 10 days where we have been now. See how much it has stayed with you. Unless there is a follow-up, a continuous follow-up, unfortunately, our circles of lives today are so diverse and busy, and problems coming up from home, so it doesn't stay. The percentage of what has been said here that will stay with you in 10 days is probably less than 1%. So this is food for thought.
Thank you very much. As we have only one panel left, as Maria suggested, to shall stay at our seats. And we have for the final panel, we have more like a keynote presentation of Vasily Sitchkin from Ukraine, since the panel is focusing on the situation of women in the current conflicted areas. Unfortunately, we didn't have people with expertise who could speak more about Iraq and Syria. Last year at the conference regarding the resolution, we had two women from Syria helping refugees with big humanitarian issues and shared very thoughtful stories. So today we will have vision and the opinion of Ms. Lisichkina from Ukraine, and then I suggest we just post the discussion. And Mr. Paul will take the moderation from here.
Actually, you made the introduction. You know anything I would like to say. So, again, before, let the revolution discuss.
Thank you very much. I won't take much time. Actually, this is the last presentation during this conference, this three-day workshop, which proved to be effective and one more opportunity for us to think about women building peace. So I want to be positive, though you know that the topic is complicated. I'm not speaking on behalf of my country here. I'm speaking on myself, from my perspective. I'm from the Donetsk region, and I have been living in Kharkiv for the last more than 10 years. But my family, my parents are internal displaced people now. A lot of my friends stayed on the occupied territory. So it's a kind of, like, you know, I wanted to show different opinions in this presentation. And of course, I want to underline once again, this is not the official thing. And I will start with visualizing. Last year, there was an initiative, and it is continued this year as well, which is a photo exhibition, which is brought to different cities of Ukraine in order to show the role of women in the conflict zone. This photo exhibition is called Women and the Conflict in Ukraine. I will take some of those photos in my presentation, as well as some other photos from my friends. As a researcher, I cannot go without some particular background for the whole situation. And you know that there is the Global Gender Gap Analysis, which is published every year based on four criteria. Based on the index for this year, Ukraine is ranked 69 out of 144 countries. Actually, we dropped significantly. You see, there is a comparison with the last decade. In 2006, our position was much better. Actually, we have quite good indexes for education and health, economy is somehow in between. But what is the problem for us is the political sphere. Actually, last year we borrowed two German Georgian ladies to our government in the security sector, Hatia Dikanidze and Tekazguladze, but they didn't manage to survive longer than 1 year. So, this is the problem that we face. We don't have a lot of female representation in politics. Probably this is why we had this fall in the last decade. Okay, closer to the positive things. As for the implementation of the resolution, this year we launched the National Plan for Implementation. And this is a roadmap for the next 4 years. Ukraine is quite active nowadays in all this. Ministry of Defense now is believed to be the first in promoting gender perspective. A lot of things have been done already there, but I'm not speaking about this. Closer to women in conflict, I tried to classify women that are in the conflict. Okay, this the borders between combatants and non-combatants is quite vague, I would say, because it's not only about women in uniform, because nowadays we have a quite significant volunteer movement and women who go to the conflict zone and they take arms and they do something what they think is important. But so, speaking about each of these categories in brief, women in the military, what we have here, significant rise in the numbers of women who want to join the armed forces of Ukraine. A lot of things are done in solving logistic problems, but still we have a lot in that sphere. Some changes were introduced to the laws concerning the positions open for women in the military and a lot of other things. We have a gender committee under the Ministry of Defense. This photo is taken by the photographer of our academy, and these are all cadets, the cadets of our academy. So still there's something like in these relations between females and males in uniform. Medics and volunteers, of course, they are in the front line. It's about those who are in uniform in the conflict zones. Those who work in hospitals, both in Ukraine and the occupied territory. Because some of the medics, some of the doctors and nurses, they had to make a choice when the conflict started, whether to stay and to help people and to do what they need to do or to move to some safer places. And that was a very hard choice in a lot of cases. And I know people who stayed just because they felt that some help was needed. You know that Ukraine was a peaceful country. We didn't struggle for independence. We got it like and that's why we don't have that much experience. So doctors had to see a lot of wounds, blood, injuries, and this is a new experience for them. What is appreciated in Ukraine is volunteer movements. We a lot of volunteers come up here, and a lot of organizations are purely female organizations, like medical sisters and all of those who help in hospitals. The next category, internal displaced people. According to the statistics, women and children constitute 2/3 of officially registered internally displaced people. All in all, we have like about 1.6 million officially registered internally displaced people. These people have to start life from scratch. And we are from those countries where women are responsible for home, for comfort, for taking care about children, for cooking, or just this is the situation like this. Here, women also face some difficulties with social welfare, how to, the social, the payments that are given by the government are not that much significant, so women have to do a lot of stuff like starting with ideas, what to do in new places, how to make these places homes, where to find job, and then education for children and all this stuff. The next category, those who stayed at home in Donetsk and Lugansk. Again, these are the photos taken from the exhibition and some of them from mass media and newspapers. Again, it's difficult, and people from the from Bosnia and Herzegovina and Serbia and Montenegro will understand how difficult it is to organize life on the Shelly. Again, some life experience.